This is an investigation into how well remains of the Chalcolithic lost wax casting technology would be preserved. Most famous for this technology is the Nahal Mishmar hoard with its numerous mace heads. Because the molds must be destroyed after casting, it was questioned how well they might be preserved in the archaeological record. While no production site for this craft is known yet, tools were cast in open molds at sites near the experiment location. Our experiments are based on the respective reconstructions and ethnographical records. The preparation of the equipment was an important part of the experiment. After a core of the mace head was made, it was covered with resin and beeswax. The inlet was attached and the object dipped into a clay slurry to make the first layer of the mold. Subsequently, more clay layers were applied, making the mold thick enough to withstand the heat. Techniques and materials available already in the Chalcolithic were also used to make the crucibles, bellows, and their tuyeres. The furnaces were prepared on the day before the experiments. For the furnace lining, local soil and chaff were collected and mixed with water. Because we have no information about how the wax was removed from the mold, a separate pit was dug to heat the molds. Finally, low furnace walls were made according to the reconstruction of the furnace used in this area nearly 6,000 years ago. The next day, the peaceful desert air of the Negev was soon filled with the typical noises of the bellows. The big day has finally come. Fire was kindled in the furnaces, and the bellows were put in position. Quickly, we were able to start with the preheating in both furnaces. Soon the furnace was hot enough to start melting the first metal batch. Copper filings and antimony shot were mixed in the crucible, while the bellow was constantly worked to keep the furnace hot. Soon after, it was time to place the first crucible in the furnace. This surely would be a pilot run, since none of us had experience in operating this kind of furnace. Whoops! This surely was not intended. But it was also the perfect opportunity to get acquainted with the furnace without the need to care about a successful run. After the crucible was covered with charcoal, it was slowly heated. Meanwhile, in the other furnace, the mold became hot enough to burn away the wax inside. And while the bellows were worked without interruption, the crucible in another run was heated long enough to expect that the copper would be molten. The wax in the mold was entirely burnt, and so the big moment finally came, casting our own mace head. Unfortunately, the results were not as expected. Only a minor part of the metal was molten, and the small pieces of charcoal on top blocked the inlet of the mold. We were too impatient. But were we successful, or did we fail? Although we did not succeed in casting, the experiments were successful. We accomplished temperatures high enough to melt copper and to produce heated mold remains which will be further investigated in the laboratory. By a lucky accident, we also proved that the furnaces could be successfully operated with a single bellow. The spilled copper melted completely. We also gained valuable information about the suitability of the local lathe for metallurgy. Tuyeres could be made on the spot, and although only sun-dried materials were used, no heat fractures occurred. With more training on the furnace, we would surely manage to better concentrate the heat inside the crucible. Last but not least, with antimony instead of copper, we even succeeded in casting.